I'm using this as an introductory slide to give you an idea of what it is we assume that you know when you come into our anatomy and physiology classes. We assume that you've completed high school and that even though it might have been some time ago, you've seen some chemistry. It's just that we understand that it might have been a while ago, or maybe you just didn't have a very good chemistry class. And so what I'm going to try to do with you today is help you walk through a review of the structure of atoms and how they're arranged on the periodic table. We're going to use that to understand a bit about things like atomic number and atomic mass, as well as how ions are created from atoms and how chemical bonds, ionic or covalent bonds, are formed between atoms. So all of this is to help you understand things like water and the larger molecules that we deal with in physiology. So you'll recognize the periodic table here, I think. The groups are the columns that go left to right. You go from element number one, which is hydrogen, all the way across to element number two, which is helium, but then you go down to the second row all the way back across to element number three, which is lithium. And I'm going to show you, I've renumbered these groups in a sort of old-fashioned numbering system. If you look at a chemistry book today, you'll see that the group numbers go 1 through 18. We're just going to ignore these 10 groups down here and use the 1 through 8 numbering system. And the reason we're going to do that is because we can. Okay, so here's my simplistic view of an atom. The dark circle here is meant to represent the nucleus of the atom, and we're going to say that each of these gray lines here represents a different shell or energy level. I'm going to write energy level just once. Oh no, apparently I'm going to write energy shell. Sometimes my hand is not connected to my brain or my mouth. So now that we know that hydrogen is element number one, and we know a little bit about the arrangement of things in the periodic table, let's look at the structure of an atom. I'm going to draw in the nucleus. Do you remember what else goes in the nucleus? That's a proton, that's a neutron, and out here in these different energy levels are the electrons, but they are in particular configurations, and those configurations are important to us. Let's review what you probably already know about atoms, which is that there are, I like to call them the big three subatomic particles, just because there are others that are out there that we're not even going to talk about. Now, when I'm trying to learn something, I like to draw tables so that I can compare one thing that I'm learning with another. So, for example, in this table, I'm going to compare the properties of protons, neutrons, and electrons. Now, protons have a mass, and it's in something called atomic mass units. They have a mass of 1. They're found in the nucleus. They have a plus 1 charge. I used to think if you were running for president, you used to have to pronounce this nucleus. Nucleus. Okay, just a little inside chemistry joke there. And you probably remember neutrons also have a substantial mass. They don't have a charge, and they're in the nucleus as well. And electrons, you may remember, have just a vanishingly small mass. It's something, you know, I'm not entirely making this number up, but I'm just rounding it off. Very, very small relative to the mass of a proton and a neutron. So we're going to essentially say they have no mass. They have a charge. They have a very important minus one charge. They're not in the nucleus. We're going to take a rather simplistic view and say that they're in orbit around the nucleus. Okay, so I'm going to draw an atom. You ready? It's really complicated. Watch. One proton, one electron. I suppose I could do that for the electron. So all atoms have the same number of protons as they do electrons. So I could say P That's it. That's an atom. They are electrically neutral. So what I've done so far is written atomic number. Let's see. That's equal to the number of protons. And so the atom that I've drawn over here that has one proton, that's element number one, which is hydrogen. Now, I wanted to talk about atomic mass in just a moment, but I thought I'd show you some things about hydrogen atoms, namely that all hydrogen atoms have one proton and one electron. What they don't all have is the same number of neutrons. So I'm going to write one neutron there and two neutrons there. These are all hydrogen. How do I know they're all atoms of hydrogen? Because they all have the same atomic number of one. See, one proton, one proton, one proton. That, by definition, means that they're hydrogen. Here, I'm going to make another table so that I can compare. I want to put protons here, neutrons here, and mass in the third row. Okay, so my first atom, I have one proton and no neutrons. I'm going to say that the mass of the electron is negligible because really it is. And so the mass, when I add that together, I get one. Over here, I have another atom of hydrogen. It has one proton, but it also has a neutron this time. Okay, so one proton plus one neutron gives me a mass of two. And over here, yet another atom of hydrogen. This one has one proton because it's hydrogen. It happens to have two neutrons, so its mass is three. So what I've drawn here are three atoms of hydrogen, and they are all what are called isotopes of hydrogen. So by definition, they have the same atomic number, right? They all have the same number of protons, different number of neutrons. So their mass is different. Now, the reason this is important to us in anatomy and physiology is because of some of the isotopes are unstable. Some isotopes are not stable. And what we mean by not stable is that they're radioactive. Radioactive. And so a radioactive isotope will decay. And so we use these. We use radioactive isotopes. Active isotopes in all sorts of cool ways. You know, X-rays, that's one, right? Just one example of how you encounter these isotopes in your future life.